There you go. Okay. Well, I know we have some people still, you know, being admitted, but I really like to make the most of everyone's time, especially now that we are in this, still this virtual blended learning. So I'm going to go ahead and kind of get us started with introductions. My name is Christy Wadehofer. I'm one of the two student support counselors on the Westlake High School campus, and we are happy just to, you know, help y'all with the speaker series every year. Again, the goal is to really bring forward speakers that have an understanding of what's going on with our community currently. So whether it's something that we're hearing directly from the students saying, hey, I wish my parents knew more about blank, or it's our parents saying, hey, I wish I understood what my kid did blank, or also just themselves being able to say, I want to be, you know, a better parent overall, and like, you know, it takes the village, and how do we do that? So we're really trying to always plan out our speaker series with people that we feel like are really going to resonate with our community. That being said, if you ever have any suggestions about a topic or a speaker, I would love to know that. You can contact me by going to the Healthy Shaps website. Truly, if you go to Google and do Healthy, C-H-A-P-S, Healthy Shaps, that's our contact information where you can email me. You can see all of our previous speaker series, the handouts, the Zooms. We also now allow these Zooms to be on podcast form due to our wonderful ed techs. So if you're ever wanting to listen on a commute while you're driving someplace, we've got you hooked up there as well. But without further ado, I'm really excited to have back our speaker. She was with us last year. She was fabulous, just a wealth of information. I know all the parents really appreciated her information as well. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Anjali Mazel.
Thanks so much, Christy. Thanks for this wonderful opportunity to share information that's really close to my heart with the Westlake community. So I am very, very happy that you've all joined me. And a little bit about me, I, after many years as a Princeton University interviewer, teacher, and TED Talk speaker on education, I founded a college admissions test prep and tutoring company. I'm also the very proud mom of a thriving 22-year-old. My mission is to guide families in planning the kind of education that not only enhances well-being, but also maximizes opportunities for college admissions, careers, and internships. I believe that it's really up to us as counselors, parents, and teens to frame the college application process constructively, because it can either be a really exhausting, short-sighted ordeal that does not deliver on its promises, or an empowering journey of self-discovery. So let's get started. Today's topic is growth mindset and college admissions. I want to let you know how exactly what you'll be learning today and the takeaways. So we've got, what is growth mindset and why is it important? Combining student talent stack, growth mindset, and purpose, a combination that I've developed that I've found to be key to admissions and scholarships. Aligning talents with life purpose and growth mindset, aligning student talents with 21st century and COVID impacted job market, and enhancing admissions and scholarship results. So I'll also be giving you some quick tips for college admissions during COVID, and do's and don'ts for applying growth mindset to the admissions process. So just some housekeeping point. I will be sending you the slides and some handouts that really are extremely useful, I think. So please feel free in the chat box, you can select to send it to me privately if you prefer. Put in your name, your email, and the grades your kids are in. You can also add your questions, because when I send you the slides, I will also answer any specific questions you have that we haven't had a chance to address today. So What is growth mindset? Now, the reason that this has become very much part of my practice as an independent admissions counselor is that there are questions that have arisen, especially in COVID, but you know, even before. How can we prepare students to thrive in this very uncertain landscape? Do students relish challenges, the challenges that lie ahead, the challenges they're facing now, or are they intimidated by difficulties? So to answer some of these questions, it's very useful to talk about growth versus fixed mindset, and also to look at what the definitions of success are that we can transmit to our teens. So let's look at a couple of points of context. The first one is really about the hyperselectivity and unpredictability of college admissions, which we all know. Here's a quote from a high school counselor who you know, puts it into very concrete terms. Then context, second part of context. Now, with that, the first part, which is the unpredictability and the selectivity of college admissions today, there's also the reality of a gap that exists between the aspirations of high school students and the reality. So this comes from study that OECD did called PISA test, which is done and compares how different countries rise to educational challenges. 85% of high school students said that they want to enter highly skilled professions, but only 17% achieved the highest level of proficiency needed to do that. So there's a huge gap there as well. And if you add to these two parts of context, the opacity, the lack of transparency, because all colleges right now are trying to find their way in this COVID-impacted landscape, you have a lot of imponderables. And so this is one more reason why growth mindset, as you will see, is very useful. So just to remind you again, some people have come in since the beginning. I'd like you to go into the chat box now and please type your questions in, your questions about college admissions related to growth mindset or just college admissions. Put your name, your email address, and the grades your kids are in. I will be able to send you the slides of this presentation, some handouts, and address your questions that I have not been able to address at the end. Very good. So growth mindset, why is it a useful paradigm? So there's a great research that has been done for a number of years now, but now it's getting kind of a boost. And it's been done at UT, Stanford, Indiana University, among others, to help bridge that gap that I talked about between student career aspirations and actual readiness in the workforce. So there was one study that was done on 12,000 high school freshmen. And when the protocol of growth mindset was applied, it actually led to increase in GPA among students who were struggling, and increase in enrollment in challenging classes among students who were already doing quite well. A second study showed that with this was 15,000 college students and 150 faculty, that when specific growth mindset protocols were implemented, and they were not actually very complicated, they were quite straightforward, then this led to increase in engagement, increase in interest, and course performance. But when the professors did not, when they implemented a fixed mindset, the opposite actually happened. So the next point is that how do we define growth mindset? So do students relish challenges? That is growth mindset is about relishing challenges, believing that hard work and mentoring can yield results, that improvement is possible, that we can learn from our mistakes, and work smarter when we fail, after we fail. And we believe that talent and potential can be developed. The fixed mindset is a completely different animal. There's fear of failure. We never want to look dumb. An aversion to effort and mentoring, because that says something about our inability to do well from the beginning. So it is a description rather than a process. Setbacks in the fixed mindset spell doom. So, you know, if I fail now, I'm going to fail forever. And belief that talent and potential are fixed. So what, of course, as you can see, if you grow with this growth mindset versus being stagnating in the fixed mindset, the definitions of success can be very, very different. So let's look at some of the ways that we can support growth mindset. We can tell students that they can grow and develop, and I will give you some growth mindset language in a minute. We can help students understand the neuroplasticity of the brain, the fact that brain can grow and adapt over time. Then the fixed mindset for that kind of languaging, we're responding to challenges by focusing on abilities instead of strategies. So we're using an example of failure to say, you can't do this because you are not. Like, you are not a math person. You are not this, you are not that. Instead of focusing on strategies for progress. Also, we predict the future based on past mistakes. Now, one thing to watch out for is there has been, since the beginning of the growth mindset research, there has been some misuse of the idea that, we have to push students to simply try harder because they can do more. That is not at all what this is about. It's really about praising the process. So sometimes as a result of this growth mindset research over the last kind of 10, 15 years, some of us have gotten into the habit of praising effort, no matter what the results are. Maybe before we used to praise just the results, now we praise the effort. So what Carol Dweck, who is one of the founder of this movement, she says that it's like praise has become the consolation prize. It is not about that. It is about rewarding the strategies that actually work to give the student a sense of progress. And also, to my mind, I've added the component of joy, because I feel that the joy of mastery, which is another element in psychology, can be used in this process to help students. Okay, so this is one of my favorite, absolute favorite things. If you haven't heard of the CV of Failures, Curriculum Vitae, or Resume of Failures, check this out. So, now, it's not this guy, Johannes Haushofer, who's an assistant professor of psychology at Princeton. It's not his idea, but he kind of got the thing going, and now there are a lot of faculty that's posting these things. And I love his quote about, the idea that if you measure a student by the accomplishments of somebody who has reached a certain level without realizing all the steps that it took to get there, you are shortchanging that student. So this is one of the things that I will be sending you as a handout. It's his CV of Failures and a couple of other links. Really fascinating stuff. So fixed mindset asks, what does this setback say about me? Growth mindset asks, what can I learn from the setback? Very key difference. So here's some language for growth mindset. And if you look at these possibilities, it's really about validating the effort, but at the same time, pointing out the progress and reminding students about the neuroplasticity of the brain. Reminding them, for example, using the phrase not yet. Not yet is one of Carol Dweck's favorite phrases. You have not learned this yet. So yet is a much more useful word than always or never. Just to pick one from here, this was a challenging task and your hard work paid off. Or the joy component for me is kind of helping students reflect on what is your favorite part about doing this? What do you enjoy about doing this? So these are some of the things that we can do. Now, what if in addition to asking these kinds of questions and responding in this way to our kids, we also ask them, again, shifting perspective, what do you think makes someone successful? And here we're moving into the kind of talent and purpose section of the talk, because growth mindset, talent development, and focus on purpose go incredibly well together. So asking them, instead of what do you want to be when you grow up, asking them what problems in our community do you want to solve? Focusing on COVID-19, there's so many things going on that are provoking that thought process in students of what are the issues in our world that we need to solve. The SDGs, again, a handout I will send you, Sustainable Development Goals, one of the tools I use to engage the students I work with in conversation about what is in this world do I want to use my talents to help, to help solve. And the idea of working with the community to help solve them. And we will see later how this dovetails with what colleges are actually looking for. So first of all, the talent. Talent stack is a concept that Scott Adams, the creator of the Dilbert comic strip, came up with. The idea that you don't have to have one outstanding talent, but a combination of different talents can be leveraged together in a unique way to add value and therefore to enable, to support a financially viable career. So how do we find the talent stack? Well, first of all, it's important to know that if you use your top four strengths daily, research shows that you'll likely thrive and think of your work as a passion. And then how can we apply growth mindset and finding the talent stack? So there are many different aspects that I use in my own process and that I encourage you to use with kids. Encourage self-reflection. There are some also great interest and strength assessments. Then there are some actual doing. There's some activities that bring out that clarify what that talent stack is. So extracurriculars, internships, classes, reading, volunteering, spending time with friends, etc. These are all aspects that framed in the right way can help students understand who they are, what they want, what they're really good at, and what they care about. And college applications can be one more element in that journey of self-discovery. So the research, how does purpose fit into this? So there is a tremendous amount of research on the health benefits, mental health, physical health benefits of purpose. The idea of what do I want my life to be about? Usually it's something that's greater than ourselves. I will share that research with you so you can see how powerful this can be in, to encourage in a young person. The steps for this kind of thing. So there are recommendations that have been put out that I will again share with you. Turning the Tide, Challenge Success, which Westlake uses a lot, and the College Transition Cooperative. These are all initiatives that are helping counselors, schools, colleges, parents reframe the college admissions process and the transition to college and the readiness preparation for college in a way that really serves students. And then I think that self-reflection is a very important component. That's why I encourage students to read about the Sustainable Development Goals and start to think about that. The path of talent, purpose, and growth mindset, this is something we will be talking about right after, just in a few minutes. So college applications and planning become, from this perspective, an opportunity to ask, how can I combine my talent stack and passions to have an impact in the world? What skills are needed in the 21st century COVID-impacted job market? And then what is the optimal way to develop those skills that I need to realize my dreams? So in this new way of looking at the whole process, we can transform college applications. And instead of focusing or, you know, encouraging students to focus and go for their quote unquote dream school, we can rely on talent development, growth mindset, and a focus on purpose to generate excitement and inspiration in the students to ultimately be able to design a life of purpose for themselves. Now, the great thing about that is that in the process of doing this, you'll see the link to college results and scholarships. So if we focus, just to drill down a little bit more, if we focus on problems to solve, either the SDGs or COVID-related, talent stack that students can discover, and what the 21st century job market, COVID-impacted job market, look like, through self-reflection, talent development, growth mindset, purpose, it actually opens up the way for enhanced college admissions and college scholarships through the selection of those activities, which then also organically lead to designing a life of purpose. So instead of doing it the other way around and trying to check off all these boxes, and have activities be kind of this kind of separate thing that we need to do because colleges are looking for it. No, it all can work together and actually then yield the results that parents are often looking for. So the question that I often get is, but will it pay? You know, if a student focuses on passion and purpose, you know, what about, you know, the financial viability of these careers? It's true that from the get-go, even before COVID, but in this context, tech is important. We need to be able to use these platforms. But, you know, students don't need to know all the platforms. They need to know what is going to be useful for the career that they want. So these are the job skills that even, as I say, before the COVID-impacted landscape, have been clearly explained to be the what will be important in the age of automation. These are the key job skills that even current employers are looking for. And they're all, you know, most of them are soft skills. And interestingly, the last one is active learning with growth mindset. So in order for a student to be even, you know, a highly valued in this job market, growth mindset and the ability to apply it is going to be very important. So as a result of these job skills being valued by employers and the predictions that have been done, like in the McKinsey report, these jobs are likely to be in high demand. Psychologists, designers, entertainers, managers, and analysts in all fields that are growing, and many more, in addition to the regular, you know, doctors, lawyers, and engineers that many of us grew up thinking, you know, if my child is successful, they need to be doing this. So just to summarize again and go back to this process, from an organic understanding and a process of talent development, self-reflection, and growth mindset, a student can develop, design a life of purpose, and at the same time, obtain enhanced college admissions and scholarships. So let's look at what this talent development process looks like. We do not have to give up the idea of well-being in order to prioritize achievement. That is unfortunately something that has led to a lot of burnout and a lot of disappointment later in life. So I try to work with students early to prevent that kind of thing. So the three D's of talent development that I have developed through working with students, discovering. Now, it doesn't have to be eighth and ninth grade. This is lifelong. But if we're looking at a high school timeline for parents who are kind of in the beginning of the process, it can help to look at it this way. So discovering, developing in 10th and 11th grade, developing those talents through all the things that I will discuss shortly, and demonstrating them in the summer and fall between 11th and 12th grade. So what does discovering look like? Again, start where you are. Those of you who are parents of eighth graders, it'll look very different than what you can do for your kids if you are parents of juniors or seniors. So open exploration, it helps to explode those preconceptions of who the kids are. Give them a chance to explore. There are a ton of local resources, even for online, like volunteermatch.org has a lot of wonderful online volunteer experiences. Shadowing also can be done online to learn about different professions. And the family vacations, staycations can be educational. Something like a virtual museum exploring. That's just one example. And nonprofits can be a way to engage at any stage of this process. Developing through the junior year. So, you know, if one passion talent blend has emerged from this whole process, that's great. But some kids are Renaissance kids. It's important to honor their passion and talent blend. Also, focus on the joy of mastery. If the time to explore can be expanded to include that development stage by connecting to purpose and growth mindset. And periodically attending national programs in the summers to integrate highest standards, if the student has certain ambitions, that can be a very useful thing. And choosing inspiring teachers and mentors, this is one of the most important aspects of that growth mindset process. And then combining talent with community service can be an incredibly powerful combination, both into the development and the discovering side of the stage of this process. And then demonstrating those talents, the third D of the three Ds of talent development during the junior and senior summer. Now competitions, this is showcasing the work that the students have done over the course of high school in the best way possible. So some of the ways of doing that are through competitions. But again, here we want to apply growth mindset to all these situations. Think about which techniques or genres best showcase that student's particular talent. And this doesn't have to just be for artists, it's for any student in any field. Always come back, help them align with their purpose, with the sustainable development goals, if those are part of what they feel is important for them, and growth mindset. And again, community service is wonderful, a wonderful way. And then there are ways of showcasing these talents that foster self-reflection at the same time. The coalition application, for example, has a locker where students can begin adding things even in the beginning of high school. There are ways to create personal websites that are really about self-reflection with blogs. There's a platform called Circled In, which I really like, which helps students, again, reflect and showcase. Same for Epic. So timeline, this is a timeline, talent development, three Ds of talent development timeline. So wherever you are on this in this process, you know, you can apply some of these things. So for all of the years, I think what's important is balanced, meaningful summers, extracurriculars aligned with talent, purpose, and growth mindset. Early test prep, I think that's useful for students who test quite easily and to get it out of the way before junior year, but it's not for everyone. And then focus on GPA, which yes is important, but then the idea of really paying attention. Are there any learning differences? Do students need extra time? All of these things are very, very important. And then campus visits to kind of get students excited about the process of college and their future. And now everything is being done virtually, so there are many, many opportunities. Even college fairs can be done virtually. So let's look year by year what this looks like. The idea of discovering, developing, and demonstrating those talents. So in the ninth grade, the things that I think are most important for the students to develop are studying time skills management, discussing those SDGs and getting that self-reflection going, and starting to prep for the tests, but or alternatively just encouraging them to read. You know, this is a very personal thing, but there are some kind of benchmarks. In the 10th grade, I give students an aptitude and interest assessment to really help jumpstart that conversation about, you know, what are my strengths, what are my interests, how can I combine them? And then we can start working on resume and portfolio. And in the 11th grade, I focus on a second kind of assessment, and we get a college list together, get the college essays, and at the end of the year, request the letters of recommendation. And then what we do is in the senior year, try to submit before the senior year begins, or you know, by September 15th. I actually have some students who've completed their process right now, so they are really going to be able to enjoy their senior year and also connect with colleges. And then in the summers can be very much about in the beginning, you know, there is some test prep. Or students, you know, the students can apply to test optional colleges. There's some amazing options for students who are not, you know, who are just not test takers or not interested in that whole process. Having said that, you know, also a lot of colleges are going to go test optional more and more after this COVID period is finished. There are wonderful things to be done in the summers. Research, internships, summer study, all aligned in the way that I explained. So, and in the summer between junior and senior year, that can be the time to really wrap it all together and present what is most compelling about their high school experience. So what's next? So let's start with two case studies of students that I've worked with and some do's and don'ts. Now, Adrienne, for example, is at St. Olaf College, which is in Minnesota. It is a liberal arts college known for its music program and its choirs. It's very often on PBS. At Christmas time, they have really something like 8 choirs, outstanding work. And then, so Adrienne, she obtained 12 scholarships, ranging from $20,000 to $100,000, and I helped her negotiate the scholarship so that it matched her first choice school. Her GPA was 3.2. She got a 29 on the ACT, and her application focus was she showed her singing talent through a music video that I helped her curate to really bring together her talents and showcase her to maximum advantage. Her essays focused on the link between singing and community service, because this is what she cared about most. She worked as in the worship band at her school and brought all her interests together. And her intended major, the stated intended major, although she wasn't sure when she was applying, but this is how we kind of helped her pull all the bits of the narrative together, was based on her level of investment in the two extracurriculars she did in college, in high school, singing and peer counseling. And so that's one kind of view of a student who is now a very happy student there. And now Tom, architecture major at Rice, he was early decision. He turned down a $100,000 scholarship from Tulane. His talent exploration took him from the idea that he wanted to be an engineer, to the idea of architecture. Now, to rephrase that, he didn't actually want to be an engineer, but everybody told him because he was good at math that he should be an engineer. So how did he end up in architecture? I will show you in a minute the different steps that we took with that. His GPA was 4.0, 34 on the ACT, 1490 on the SAT, Math 2 and Physics SAT were 800. So he had strong testing. His application focus was demonstrated visual art talent through carefully curated portfolio. So because he loved art, and I discovered this kind of by chance, and he was actually turned out to be very good at it, I gave him some opportunities to work with a local art mentor. I paired him with this mentor. I had him attend the Rhode Island School of Design summer program. He developed a portfolio, which then enabled him to combine his abilities in math and his interest in art into a career that really made sense for him. And his essays reflected that. And he wrote about his relationship to a community building. Another essay he wrote was on solving a problem in one of his art pieces the way he would solve a mathematical equation. So now let's look at some tips specific to COVID-19, which these I'm sharing with you because I participated in a lot of meetings with selective college admissions staff over the last months, and some of these you may know, some of these you may not, but I wanted to be sure to share them. So the informed, you know, whether you're a parent of a senior or junior, and you want to stay informed, keep it to the absolute minimum because things change so quickly. It's not worth kind of, you know, being on a list that updates you every day. It's kind of crazy making. So that's my recommendation. Here are some great websites to just check in with periodically. Now, just for the people who might have come in late, I will be sending you these slides and these resources. So just please feel free to put your name and your email and the ages of your kids and any questions you have in the chat box. With a reduced emphasis on SAT and ACT, a lot of more emphasis on the application process is going to be through the essays, letters of recommendation, the interviews. A lot has been said about, you know, what does test optional mean, and is it, you know, is it really test optional? In the end, the students who submit those SAT and ACT scores this year, they're going to be students who have done really well in them because the others are not. So admissions knows that, and, you know, it is going to be looking much more closely at some of the other things, which actually is good news because as more and more schools become test optional, things like character are going to become much more important, and growth mindset helps in developing that. There will be fewer international students, so the need for full-paced students will rise, especially at the liberal arts colleges. However, that may be counterbalanced by the fact that there are a significant number of deferrals at a lot of these colleges for next year. So there may be, you know, that may kind of balance itself out. There will be also fewer out-of-state students applying, so out-of-state applicants may have an advantage. The thing that all the colleges said is please have the students leverage the online opportunities, the virtual information sessions. The UT, for example, has virtual classrooms that a student can attend to see, you know, what is it like to be in a classroom at UT? There are virtual Q&A sessions with current students. There are many, many different ways to connect. A few more things for the seniors this year. There is a COVID-related essay prompt. Really, it's only for students who have been extremely impacted in the sense of their grades, especially their grades, if their academic performance has been impacted by COVID, and if their family circumstances have been impacted. Students this year will not be penalized for a lack of traditional extracurriculars. And actually that applies to juniors too, because whatever's not available this year, you know, and in fact, that actually also applies to sophomores. So the idea is really to focus on opportunities. What are the opportunities in this current landscape? And I will be sharing with you a handout with a list of online activities that students can engage in. So the focus on character, as I said, fits in with growth mindset, the development of grit and compassion. These are trying times. And if we can help our students see that there are ways to grow as a person and as a student through these times, we're really doing them a great, great favor. So then what we're going to look at is what the do's and don'ts are. So please, don't do this. Don't put it off. Think about, you know, get that information. You'll have access to my timeline. Think about, you know, what can I be doing to support my student in the college planning process? Also, don't buy into myths. So I'd like to know if you think these are true or false. I'm not going to be looking at the chat box until later, but just think about it yourself. My children need to get into top 10, 100 ranked schools to be successful. If they don't get into X school, their lives will be ruined. If they don't become doctor, lawyer, engineer, they will be poor. So these are false, and I will show you why they are false, because research shows that the best predictors of success are not school rank, but they are the following, and this ties into growth mindset as well. Being closely mentored by professors in college, that is one of the most powerful ways to grow as a student and become inspired about possible career options. Engaging with college community in an active way. Studies have been done about the sense of belonging, how that impacts academic performance. It is significant. If more students get involved and connect, and feel that they understand what the benchmarks are and the stages are in their progress, the better the results are. And I add these things, choosing work that is in line with 21st century job skills, things that you, not the robots, not the AI, can do. And then growth mindset, joy of mastery, and purpose. These are lifelong gifts that can enhance and really make such a huge difference in the life of a student. So here are some more do's and don'ts. There's the idea of fit over rank, defining, redefining success. The Turning the Tide handout that I will give you research, the research on that. And again, I summarized it in the previous slide. Reframing the college application process as one step in designing a life of purpose, teaching growth mindset. Timeline is key. It is great if possible. Now, of course, if your student is a 12th grader, you know, don't worry about it. But if possible, to try to submit applications, especially for rolling admission schools, closer to when the applications open than when they close. Because resources are allocated in certain situations, they are allocated kind of on a first come, first serve basis. And then supporting kids in being okay with not knowing what they want yet. So the idea of kind of purpose, this conversation, it's not about pushing kids to understand purpose at 14, 16, 18 years old. That's not the idea. The idea is engaging them in a lifelong conversation, starting the process so that they really are aligning their choices with who they are and what they care about. And then the application strategy, make sure it's in line with the Earth's authentic selves. We hear this from college admissions all the time, be authentic, be authentic. It might sound like some kind of buzzword, but actually, as I've shown in this process, if we support students from the beginning in really understanding themselves, understanding what their strengths are and how their gifts can make an impact in the world, then there's nothing buzzwordy about it. It's just very, very simple. It is an organic process that leads in the end to enhanced, as I said, enhanced college admissions and scholarships. So in the narrative of these applications, try to tie the extracurriculars in and the career goals together in that organic way. Also, a few more things. Demonstrated interest. Some schools say they don't look at that. And, you know, in this landscape with COVID, demonstrated interest has become even more important. And schools are really needing to try to predict their yield. That is the college strategic enrollment management. So when a student is interested in a school, engage with that school. Clean up the digital footprint. This is important because also moving online, social media is kind of more and more important in the college admissions process. So just be sure to keep an eye out for that. I do give students that I work with a course to take, which is very short online interactive course, to know how to create. It's not just about cleaning up the digital footprint, it's about having an online presence that is in line with who they are and what they care about. And then document early, keep videos and photos of student accomplishments in a file. And this can help later on in the showcasing, the third D of talent development at the end. And then go deeper, not wider. Help students not think that they have to do everything, but really focus on what they care about and the joy of accomplishment. And rely on informed guidance as early as possible. So what does that look like? Informed guidance in the U.S., the average number of public school students to counselors in the U.S. is 455 to 1. So you, in this process, ask yourself, how much guidance will I and my student need in the college planning and application process? And there is a handout I'm going to send you which has all the steps, so you can ask yourself, which of these steps do I need guidance with and which do I don't? Also, don't I? And then ask your child's counselor, you know, how many students are you working with? How much time do you spend with each student? And if you do work with an independent counselor, be sure that they belong to one of the associations like IECA that vets them, because it's kind of a protection for families as well. So I will be sharing resources with you, all the lists of the different research that I mentioned, as well as some books and some articles. And at this point, you know, I know from my own experience, as a parent, my own experience as a professional, that if we help students discover their talents and design a life of purpose that, you know, where joy is at the center, the financial viability and the success come organically with that. And, you know, I know that that's what we all want for our kids. We want them to thrive. So thank you so much for being with me today. And I really look forward to reading some of your comments. If you haven't done so, please leave me your name and email so that I can send you all the resources. Christy, do you want to, let's see, I could look in the chat box now and see about questions. What do you think?
I know that there was at least one question in the chat box amongst the names and emails. Mm-hmm. Do you recommend SAT prep institutes? And if so, can you can you name a top successful one?
Okay. Yes. Yeah, so, absolutely. I mean, there are some great, you know, test prep companies out there. I handpick my test prep tutors from Princeton and other Ivies, just because with Princeton, you know, being an alum, I know the community, I feel comfortable. And so I handpick them and work with them to design a really, you know, outstanding test prep program. So, you know, that's the one I'm familiar with. I have over the years recommended different tutors locally to people who didn't want to work online, because my tutors do work online. So please do contact me if you want, you know, kind of more details on that. I don't want to spend too much time on test prep just because there might be some other questions, but absolutely I'll be happy to you know, send you information about my program, but also some local people in Austin if anybody's interested that I know. Here we go. Are there many changes related to COVID for student athletes? So there are changes. I have actually somebody on my team who specialized in athletic recruitment. So if you have not yet, I think it's Christy, please send me your question exactly and your email and all that and the grade that your a student is in, and I will be really happy to send you all the information. Yeah. Anybody else with any questions about, you know, the college admissions process, college planning, you know, growth mindset, let's see, or even gap years. I see there's somebody is saying that they have a child who is delaying the start for college. Does anybody, do you have a question about that? I mean, I'll just speak briefly on that until I get any other questions. So a lot of students actually are doing that. There are some great ways to spend a gap year. And now with the COVID situation, there are some online, very good online programs. You know, again, if you're interested in that, please let me know, because I have developed two programs, one called Propel, which is about helping students in a gap year connect with companies, find internships, or if that doesn't seem to be their cup of tea, create a personal project. You know, anything from creating a nonprofit to I've had a student do online concerts to raise money for certain charities. So if you're interested in that, let me know, and I'll be very happy to share that information. It says, will we have access to this Zoom recording after the meeting? I think so, right, Christy? And
yes, so yeah. We are recording this, and it'll be probably up by this afternoon at the latest tomorrow on the Healthy Shaps website. So again, if you go to Google, Healthy, C-H-A-P-S, we are the very first thing that comes up, and we have a link that says, you know, presentation, podcast, handouts, and that's where you'll be able to find this.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you. Question about UT admissions process, what is important for them for selection? UT is very much fit to major. So what we need now, your question, you know, would help me if I knew, I think it's Reza, what grade your child is in, because there's more or less things that can be done about that depending on how early, you know, we start looking at the process. But the fit to major is very important. So what does that mean? That means that the grades, that the extracurriculars, that the, you know, the student's passion really needs to, remember I talked about the narrative for the application. It really all needs to fit together in a very powerful way to show that the fit between what the student wants to do and what they're, you know, so far have been able to do aligns. So that's another reason. Now, UT is not the only college that is very much fit to major. So this is another reason why it's so helpful to work early, you know, with students to try to help them, you know, understand what they're, you know, if they have a calling or if they have a passion talent blend, or like some of the parents here mentioned, they have Renaissance kids, right, who have many different talents. How can that fit together to yield the admission, the scholarship, and the career that is really going to benefit that student, that's really going to allow that student to share their gifts with the world? So this is a way to rethink the idea of, well, what does my kid have to do to get into X school? I totally understand the question about UT admissions, but I'm just encouraging everyone to think, in terms of fit. You know, you could even think about it, you know, we talked about fit over rank. It's almost like, you know, what fits with that student for their lives? How can that look? You know, encouraging that student to think, to envision a future that they would really like to participate in. Okay, so let's see. Anybody else? Please indicate in the chat the link where the presentation will be available. Can you do that?
I did drop that into the chat.
Oh, you did that. Thank you. Thank you. Let's see. Did I miss anything?
I don't think so.
Yeah.
You know, again, a reminder to please, you know, whether you want to put it on publicly in the chat or just directly to Anjali with your email address and your the age of your children or the grade of your child, any specific questions you might have, and she'll take the time to respond to those privately. Otherwise, you know, we'll give it a couple more moments here, but we do appreciate everyone who signed on today. And Anjali, you were a wealth of information as always. We're so appreciative to you and grateful for you coming back and spending your time with us, especially during such, I know we're tired of hearing the words unprecedented times and weird year, but it truly is, and we are all flying the plane while building it. So we appreciate you being here with us while we do that.
Thank you so much, Christy. Thank you. And thank you, Colleen, also from the West Bank Library. I really appreciate having this platform and opportunity, and for all your help. Thank you again. Really appreciate that.
Thank you.
It's so wonderful to be able to share this information with, you know, teachers and parents and counselors. And, you know, I really feel very strongly that if we work together, we can big changes can happen. So thanks again.
Yes, agreed.
Thanks again.
Thank you everyone for joining us. We look forward to seeing you in future sessions. I'll have more information about that also on the Healthy Chefs website. So, and it'll be coming via email as well.